I'll give you a little bit of background and then do a bit of a check-in on where things are now. As things have moved and continue to move, and really for the safety of all, require ongoing monitoring. And so, as you all know, several weeks ago, we released guidance that envisioned a number of classroom settings and what school would be like when we open in the fall. As we find ourselves, 3 weeks away for some districts, 4 weeks for others, we know that conditions have changed significantly. And those conditions warrant school districts taking steps that I would say require an abundance of caution to think through how reopening might take place and to prepare some contingency plans if conditions persist in a way that we're not able to safely open schools. As we've always said, safety is paramount. It is the most important factor in how we reopen. As you know from many of my remarks, I often talk about the three pillars that I think are important for us during this pandemic. One is to follow safety, health guidance, and science guidance on how to safely reopen schools. And if it's not safe to do so, then schools should not reopen in a way that would put students or staff in harm's way. We have to continue to think about the social emotional learning needs of our students. Our students will need counseling. I'll talk a little bit about some additional information that we intend to provide to school districts should we find that many school districts need to move into distance learning. And of course, that plays into the continuum of learning, meaning quality around standards around distance learning. I'm happy to talk a little bit more about that today. But since we've issued our guidance, conditions have changed dramatically. We know that in many communities throughout our state, we're seeing high rates of infection in the community. This surge has spelled the need for caution and for us to move cautiously, even as we get closer to the beginning of school. Now, the reality is that we have some counties in this state where the number of cases is actually quite low. And those counties are situated in a way that schools in those counties will actually be able to open. And if they're following the guidance that we know our health experts have provided, hand washing, 6 feet of spacing, maintaining physical distance, and of course, everyone wearing a face covering, we believe that those schools can open safely. We believe that schools should continue their plans to open safely. And at the end of the day, the way it works in California is that the decisions around opening are made at the local level. They're made by local school districts and their superintendents working together. We try to help guide those decisions. And we also know that those decisions are guided by the actions of health officers, in many cases, county health officers. For those reasons, this week, we did convene a meeting of all of the county health officers, and we organized them into regional clusters so that we could have county health officers together with county superintendents of education and our staff talking about ways that we all have to move together to make sure that schools open safely. We want to ensure that we provide as much information as we can in a time when it's hard to get clarity. Let's face it, a lot of what we're dealing with the coronavirus is not a settled science, but when we act on the things that we know to be true, wearing face coverings, maintaining physical distancing, we know that these things will make a difference in keeping all of our students safe. And so as our schools continue to make their plans for reopening, I want to acknowledge that two of our larger school districts, Los Angeles Unified and San Diego Unified, have made the decision that a number of other districts have made to open in a distance learning mode, meaning to start school year in distance learning and to continue to monitor the conditions. And should things change, then shift to an in-person instruction mode. And we support that decision of those schools. They're putting safety first. We know, for example, in the case of Los Angeles County, the data shows that the rate of case infection is quite high, much higher than in many other communities. And so we applaud the superintendent and the school boards in Los Angeles and San Diego for making the decision to say, let's open safely and to continue to monitor. At the same time, a number of our districts have asked to have more metrics that help them understand whether or not it is safe to open after they've been in distance learning, what they should be thinking about before opening. And we were working with a number of health officials to see how we might be able to help provide those kinds of metrics that will give schools' indicators about when it's safe to open and when it might not be safe to open. And so we continue the conversations with districts, with the California Department of Public Health, with many, to talk about how do we prepare for school opening in the fall. And I wanna also acknowledge that we have some districts that are being creative, and they're looking at a kind of hybrid model where they might open in distance learning, but they may create a kind of technology pod or a childcare pod where small groups of students whose parents have to work will be able to participate in distance learning with the support of caring adults, trained staff who can support them by engaging in distance learning while their parents are at work. And so we know that there are many questions that we need to continue to answer. We continue to monitor the conditions on a daily basis. We continue to consult with health officials as to how we support schools. And we continue to be in conversation with many of our school districts, sometimes through their associations, but we continue to be in touch with our school districts, with our employee groups, and we appreciate all those who've raised the key need for us to make safety paramount. And so at this time, the order of the day is to continue to plan, continue to monitor, and as needed, to create contingency plans if the conditions don't change. If the conditions that we see now, you know, continue, and if school were to open tomorrow, it seems clear that we would need to be in a protective mode, and that distance learning would provide that. We're gonna continue to monitor and continue to work with our school districts to see how they prepare for the coming days and for the opening of school. There are many questions, but we can answer those questions together. There's much that we can do together. You know, it hasn't always been the case that the Department of Education would convene county health officers, but we see the need for information to flow seamlessly, even in a time when there are many questions. And we're focusing on answering those questions with the data that we have and working together to find more data that allows us to keep our students safe. I do want to mention briefly that should our schools open in distance learning, they will be aided by additional kinds of guidance that the California Department of Education will provide that speaks to standards around distance learning. And we envision that this additional guidance will really be informed through our partnerships with the State Board of Education and the Governor's Office, and of course, we work closely with our stakeholder groups, our teachers and classified staff, our school administrators and our county superintendents, to really think through how much live instruction really needs to be in place so that our students are getting good contact with their teachers. To think through issues around taking attendance, to make sure that students who don't check in, that there's an outreach policy to make sure that we check in on those students, that we provide them connection to social emotional learning programs. Many of you know that I've organized a counseling coalition. It's an ad hoc group, really working in grassroots way to help us figure out how to fill gaps in systems that we know that have been interrupted because of the pandemic and because of the lack of funding at the state. And so our counseling coalition will continue to work on building a patchwork quilt of support so that schools that do open in distance learning will have additional support to those California state school counselors and school psychologists who are working with our students. Will be complementing that with work of some community-based organizations and other counseling groups that will be able to provide support. Many of you know that last week we also held a hearing on how to maximize some existing funding streams that might help us to get more counseling. This grew out of a conversation about creating some alternative programs, the police programs on campus. What became clear is that there are some federal dollars through Medi-Cal and similar programs that can be expanded, but schools need help to have a match for how to access those dollars. We've got a task force focused on expanding existing programs like Medi-Cal, like the LEA billing option, like programs like Title IV-E, that will allow us to look at ways to expand those dollars for more counseling programs, more nursing programs, perhaps more psychologists, all of the programs that we know are gonna be important. And of course, if we find ourselves with schools entering in distance learning, we'll be paying close attention to how we offset learning gaps, how we support the learning needs of our students. We've been working hard to expand internet, and our task force on closing the digital divide has gotten great commitments from internet service companies to provide free internet and reduce cost internet, but we have much more work to do. We'll be expanding our work to see how we get more computer donations in place in time for school. And even beyond school, we'll be working to close the digital divide. We'll be doing all that we can to support English learners and students with disabilities to ensure that they get support. Expect to get more from the California Department of Education in the days and weeks to come on how, if we have to have more distance learning, there's more professional development for teachers and educators to support our students, that we do more work to make sure there's consistency across our classroom. We're not saying there's going to be a one-size-fits-all, because our state is diverse, and our communities in our state are quite diverse. But we also know that there needs to be certain standards of consistency that look similar across our school sites. Our families need it. They deserve it. Our students deserve it. And while we are prioritizing safety, we want to continue to do our work in a way that affords quality of education and learning to our students. And so that's it for now. I invite your questions, and I invite you to continue to stay tuned for updates from the California Department of Education as we continue to work to support our 6 million students in the state of California during this time.
All right, thank you, Superintendent. And we've got a number of questions that came in via email, and if you're using the Zoom Q&A, if you could identify yourself and your media outlet as we take follow-up questions. But the first question here is from Sosin Marar from the Sacramento Bee. Her question is a two-part question. The first one is, what do you think is the likelihood that more California school districts will begin fall classes through distance learning? And the second part of the question is, I understand that school districts are watching these next few critical weeks as Governor Newsom announced more closures. But if we execute concrete decisions now to begin fall with distance learning, that will give school districts more time to improve their program. What are your thoughts on shifting to this strategy instead, given that distance learning was imperfect in the spring?
You know, the question has to do with the likelihood of more districts entering into district learning, and how will the quality distance learning be better if we find ourselves there. I do think that if school had to open tomorrow, most of our districts would open in distance learning. And that is a decision that I think is a good decision if conditions don't change. Right now, we're talking with health officers about the kind of metrics we need to see, the kind of, you know, the case numbers that would need to decrease and by what percentage that would send a signal that it's safe to be open. But now is the time for people to be cautious and to make contingency plans, including to plan for distance learning. I do want to say that now is also a time for us to accelerate our efforts at doing the things that we know can allow us to reverse this trend. That now more than ever, we need everyone to be wearing a face covering wherever you go. That we all need to maintain physical distancing and continue hand washing. And just, oh, these are things that we can control. We can take steps that can help us to be in a better place to open when school would open in the fall. And if we're not able to open in person, those steps will still pay off, because all the districts that have announced moving into distance learning have generally said they want to open that way and continue to monitor until it's safe to move into distance learning. In terms of how we'll address the, you know, there's no question that, you know, our schools moved into distance learning with almost no preparation, with almost no warning. And this is a model that is new for almost all of our school districts. And so now, as we consider the possibility of many school districts entering into distance learning, if they don't feel that the conditions safely allow them to open and they consulted with health officials and they just don't see it to be safe, we want them to take an abundance of caution. And if they move into distance learning, we believe that there will be more quality in distance learning, that there'll be more training for our educators. And since the distance learning period, the California Department of Education has provided nearly 40 webinars on doing distance learning. But we'll be working with local school districts on how they can provide localized, customized training for their staff on distance learning. As I mentioned earlier, we envision providing more guidance around how quality standards around distance learning might look from classroom to classroom. More information about what's a good best practice for the amount of time that a student should have live instruction, because we know students do better when they can see their teachers. Even if it's only on the computer screen, that's an important contact for our students. We know some didn't have that. We know that we have to continue to do work to get more computer donations to support our students who are without computers. And our schools have to have the ability to do family engagement, to take phone calls from families that may not have access to email, that may still be relying on paper packets, to have strong, robust family engagement programs. We'll be talking with our school districts about that, to make sure that our families that struggle for basic needs, that don't have access to computers, that they don't get left behind, that they have access to resources and support that enable their students to be successful as we all try to get through these very challenging times.
Right, thank you. Our next question is from Vanessa Roncagno at KQED in San Francisco. She says, hi there. Can the superintendent address the California Teachers Association's July 8th letter advocating for the school year to begin in distance learning until the virus is contained? And what is the superintendent's message to teachers who doubt their district's ability to keep school communities safe when their classrooms have poor ventilation, or schools may run out of soap or hygiene materials? And what is your message to those teachers that have those concerns?
The question is about the California Teachers Association. They've sent a letter to the governor, myself, and the leaders of the legislature raising concerns. And I think I just have to say our teachers have raised legitimate concerns that we need to be as cautious as possible. They're asking for more data and more metrics that show it's safe to open before any school district opens. And they're right. Every single school district in our state, all 1,000 of them, need to really look at what the current health conditions are. And they need to ask themselves, are we in a place where we can provide 6 feet of distance, where we can provide face covering, where we can ensure the safety for all of our students and staff? That is paramount. I'm grateful to the governor's office, who's the Office of Emergency Services, who has helped us to get the personal protective equipment that's going out to all of our schools. And that's critical, but we have to make sure that there's enough. And in this time where budgets have been tough, we have to make sure that we have more personal protective equipment to support all of our schools. So I appreciate the concerns raised by teachers to say, let's make sure that we get this right, that we cannot guess. We have to follow facts and the data that we know to be true. And any place where there's uncertainty, we should proceed with caution. In many cases, that's gonna mean opening and distance learning until we have more information. We applaud those leaders for making those decisions. We're available to help school districts that are making those decisions. We'll continue to work with school districts and health officials at the county level and the State Department of Public Health. We believe that new information has come out from the Department of Public Health. They've made it clear that there'll be more testing that can take place in school districts. They just announced that information yesterday. We know that more information will be coming on the actual health and science kinds of questions from the California Department of Public Health. We look forward to that and helping to get that information out to teachers, to educators of all kinds, and to our schools and students and our families.
All right, the next question is from Diana Lambert at EdSource, and this is a two-part question. She said the governor has indicated that there will be additional guidance regarding masks, choirs, contact sports, remote instruction. Do you have an update? Do you know if students will be required to wear masks in schools? The second part of the question is, increasingly school districts are starting with distance learning because of the rising number of COVID-19 cases. Do you expect that the state will mandate that schools remain closed this fall?
Thanks for the question about new guidance that may be coming out from the California Department of Public Health. And while I cannot speak to it because I don't have access to all of it, I do know that the California Department of Public Health is working around the clock to update guidance, provide additional guidance that addresses school safety. As I mentioned just yesterday, they announced in their guidance additional information that will speak to providing more testing at schools and how that testing will be paid for, which is an important step in the conversation. I do believe that the California Department of Public Health will be making some announcements. The time frame, I don't know, but I know that they're working around the clock, and I know that it's their interest to be able to speak to the questions that were raised here today about extracurricular activities, about issues related to face coverings, and there'll be some updates in those areas. And I believe that the Department of Public Health is working to provide the best information available to help ensure that our schools can be safe. And so We'll stay tuned for that information. I would just say, Diana, that as you know, the California Department of Public Education oversees three schools that serve deaf students and blind students. And we're very proud of our students. And we've made the decision as well that those schools will open in distance learning as a start, so that we can continue to monitor conditions around the state. Those schools have residential programs, and that means that students come from many, many counties. And so that means we have to be extra thoughtful about cohorts and bubbles that can be created for safety. And for those reasons, we're making the decision that those schools will open in distance learning. But we believe that we can continue to monitor the data, and should the data show that it's safe to do so, we want to open those schools for in-person instruction. I believe that that's the approach that other school districts are taking, to many of them saying that they're going to open in distance learning, but really leaving the door open to say that they will open for in-person instruction if and when it's safe to do so. I think it's easier to make that decision to say to start. If there are any safety concerns, it's easier to open in distance learning, and then to say when safe to do so, we'll move to in-person instruction. And I applaud those districts that have made those decisions, because they had safety data that showed that was the right thing to do and the safe thing to do. I applaud them.
We have a question here from Heather. I'm sorry. We have a question here from Heather Jansen at CBS 13. She said, a number of parents are concerned about distance learning and students who have IEPs and learn in person. Would there be standards set for accommodations for these students so they can still get individualized education?
You know, the question about providing support to students in special education through distance learning is one that we're very focused on. We've provided webinars nearly every week on how to ensure that students with disabilities are able to receive support through distance learning. And the federal government, through rulings, has made it possible to say that special education can be delivered through special education. We want to see more training for educators and for the one-on-one aides who support students. We need to make sure that students have access to computers and devices so that they can continue to get special education. I know that even a few districts I've heard that they intend to create small pods for students with disabilities to get in-person instruction because their need warrants that. And so it varies according to district, but the California Department of Education, the State Board of Education, will be working to provide training support, additional information, additional guidance that really helps to support our districts in providing the highest level of support to our students with disability, even if that has to happen through distance learning.
We've got at least one more question here. This one is from Joe Bowers at California Black Media. It's about the digital divide. And do you know current estimate of children without access to devices for virtual learning? Do you think the digital divide can be bridged in time for the fall?
The question is about the digital divide. What we've uncovered is that there are hundreds of thousands of students without a computing device or access to steady internet. We think we've helped to move that through my task force on closing the digital divide. Our first response was to respond to the pandemic, and we've been able to get internet service providers to make commitments to students all across the state for free internet and reduce the cost of internet. There are some structural barriers to providing internet in the state that are gonna, have been a challenge for decades, and they're gonna take some time to work through. And so I do believe that the digital divide can be bridged. And I believe that in this moment, as we respond to the pandemic and the students' need for technology, we're going for the moonshot. We're saying we must close the digital divide once and for all. This divide is embarrassing. It has existed for decades. It disproportionately impacts students of color and low-income students and rural students. And in a state with California's wealth and access to technology, there's no reason for it to exist. We're going to continue our work until we end it. Obviously, we're just a few weeks away from school. And so it would seem unlikely that we could literally close pace on hundreds of thousands of devices in the next few weeks. And I have to say that while it's not ideal, it is possible for distance learning to happen without computing devices. But we prefer that we be in a one-to-one environment where every student has a device. We're going to work until we get that done. And we know that time is of the essence and there's urgency. And for all those who are following in the media and on social media who can help, we're asking for your help. We know that we need help from California companies and individuals and foundations. I'm grateful to those who've come forward. And those who want to help can do so at donatetech@cde.ca.gov. Again, that's donatetech@cde.ca.gov. The time is urgent, and we welcome your support.
Okay, and we only have time for one more question. For our last question, this is Vicky Gonzalez from KCRA3 in Sacramento. And she asks if you know whether there will be any additional resources for parents who work or rely on school for childcare, as well as additional educational resources, mental health, or other resources for physical activity and things that support parents.
You know, in terms of resources to support parents and working parents, I know that the budget approved by the legislature and the governor has some $5.2 billion in it to address a number of concerns around distance learning. We want to unpack that to see how that best rolls out. Clearly, we continue, like every other state, California continues to need support from the federal government. For all of you who are hearing this broadcast, we need you to make your voices heard, to say that we need the HEROES Act to be passed that provides additional dollars that can be used for computing devices, for mental health resources. Our office is leading an effort to maximize the use of existing state and federal resources. And I want to thank the California Department of Healthcare Services Agency and the California Department of Social Services for joining us. A number of foundations that have joined us. I expect more updates as we try to leverage these additional dollars to support our needs. The state budget that has passed also has resources in it for community schools that can have health and mental health resources in it. We'll have to see how that folds out. Ultimately, we're looking to maximize resources, and we know that parents need to be able to work. And so some school districts are working to create additional childcare supports if they're going to be in distance learning so that parents have those supports. Stay tuned, and we will continue to provide that information as it becomes available to us. We're literally surveying every district on how they're planning to reopen.
That was our final question that we have time for. So if you have any closing remarks, I'll hand it back over to you, Superintendent.
Thank you, sir. And thank you all who participated today. We know there are a lot of questions. We're going to answer them together. We ask you to continue to make safety our first priority. Grateful to all of our educators, administrators, our students, our families for what they're doing. In the meantime, we can continue to improve our conditions by doing the things that we can control, washing our hands, wearing face coverings at all times, always maintaining physical distance. Let's do those things together and for each other so we can get closer to a safe opening of school in the fall. Thank you for now, and continue to be well.